Last week, brothers and sisters, I laid down a bit of a gauntlet, didn't I? Said we have to know how to defend our faith. And I realized that I can't just say that one Sunday and then the next Sunday forget I ever said it, right? I have to back it up. Can't just make boasts. I have to support it. So today, and hopefully, God willing, over the next couple of weeks, my hope is to present to you some evidences and some discussion, as it were, about how we can support our faith in the face of some of the main challenges that Christians are facing today about their faith. And there's a number of different challenges that are very popular right now that have gained a lot of traction in academia, in the media, and so forth. You see it from these kind of goofy documentaries on the History Channel to the highest levels of the ivory tower. Ways in which traditional understanding of Christianity and the traditional claims of Christianity are being undermined. So today I'm going to hurt your brain a little, hopefully. Sorry, normally I like to uplift your spirit. Today I want to hurt your brain a little, so you might find it boring. I don't know. We'll see. I want to challenge you. So the first one of the main challenges today, and one that we can look at today, is how can you trust anything about anything in Christianity because you base it on this New Testament, this Bible, and this Bible has been edited and modified and changed and adjusted over century after century after century. How do you know that what you have is even close to the original? How do you know that all that stuff about Jesus as the Son of God or Jesus being risen from the dead wasn't added in later by zealous fanatic followers who really wanted to kind of up the story for their maybe out of devotion, maybe out of pure desire for gain, who knows? And this is exactly the kind of argument which is being made. Now you all know the telephone game, right? When I was at Camp Vatra, I illustrated the telephone game. I started on one end of the class, and we went around to the other. It was only 18 kids. And I whispered into one kid's ears, Jesus Christ is risen from the dead. Nice and quiet, so only he would hear. And I said, now pass it on. And of course, it went around. By the end, it came out, it was a Romanian kid, so it came out, Diana Sfânta, which means Holy Diana. Which, of course, is nothing what I said. So doesn't that prove that you can't trust the gospel? I mean, isn't that a great evidence for why you can't trust the gospels? Well, that is a great argument if that's exactly the way the gospels were transmitted over centuries after century after century, from one ear to another, without any kind of cross-checking or cross-reference. But the fact is, we don't have only one stream of transmission from one person to one person to one person. We have multiple streams of transmission through groups of people to groups of people to groups of people. And scholars who have studied oral tradition even, not to even talk about the literate tradition, have demonstrated in many traditional societies, oral transmission is often just as reliable, sometimes even more reliable than written transmission. Because once you write it down, you kind of forget it, right? It's somebody else's problem. When you're in an oral tradition society, you have to make sure that you get it right. And you have a whole group of people around you ready to correct you because they know it themselves. They've all devoted it to memory. Now, we don't have that issue because the Gospels themselves were written very soon after the life of Christ. Even a conservative estimate, which is accepted by most scholars, puts them around 60 to 70 AD, okay, right around the fall of Jerusalem, in the lifetime of the apostles. And John's gospel is the last, comes in around 96 AD, but he's still alive. So only a few scholars have tried to push the dating of the New Testament beyond the life of the apostles, but they're a minority. When you have this kind of incredible body of scholarly agreement, though, over dates and things like that, you don't sit there and go, well, you know, this one guy, he came up with another theory, so that must be, and that's just something different. So we're going to go with him. You know, well, that's what the news media does. The news media says, wow, somebody's saying something different and controversial and exciting. Because it's not news to say, guess what? Today, Jesus Christ is still the Son of God, risen from the dead. Next, the weather. You don't do that. So that when the media, when some guy shows up or lady shows up in academia and says, I've got a new theory, everybody rushes and said, yes, speak into the microphone. Now, most of us understand that that's not really how scholarship works. But there's a lot of people who love this stuff. They just jump right onto it and they grab it right away. They say, see, that stuff was made up many, sometimes maybe centuries later. Those same people get very mad when you deny climate change, by the way. Right? Because after all, the science is settled. 97% or something of scientists all agree that climate change is happening and that it has a human basis. Okay, well, if that's a basis for, and I agree with that. I don't have any problem with that. I don't agree with Rush Limbaugh, unfortunately. I don't think it's a hoax. I have a degree in environmental studies. I'm pretty sure the science is sound. If you don't apply the same standard of evidence, though, to Scripture, and say, well, you know, 97% of those people all say that the New Testament is very reliable to the original texts. And that they're written in the time of the apostles. But this 3% over here says it's a hoax. Well, we're going to go with them. Okay, there's a little disconnect there, I think. There's a little lack of continuity in your thought process. A lack, perhaps, of integrity intellectually. But today I want to talk about the harder question. The harder question is, but how do you know that the text, even if you had the original text, how do you know that that text is still true to the original? This is where I want to hurt your brain a little more if I haven't already. Today we read in this gospel, this beautiful gospel of the healing of the son of this father. The father says, literally it says in the gospel, he's a lunatic or moonstruck. And it's sometimes translated as epileptic or epileptic. But I like the phrase moonstruck. I think that's truer to the Greek. And so that way it's not trying to confuse it with a medical diagnosis, which it's not. It's the father saying, the guy, my son has lost his mind, is what he's saying. He's hurting himself. Help him. Nobody can help him. He's got something wrong. And Jesus is able to heal him, but the disciples were not. And Jesus upbraids his disciples why they couldn't heal this young man, because they didn't have faith. They had faith even like a mustard seed. They would have been able to move mountains, but they didn't have enough faith. And then there's this one verse, Matthew 17:21, which says, however, this kind cannot come but through prayer and fasting. Okay, you cannot cast this demon out through prayer and fasting. Now, if you have an Orthodox study Bible or another study Bible of another sort, you may have noticed in the margins a little note that says, and you omits this whole verse. That means to say that there is a stream of transmission of the Gospels which does not include that verse. It's just cut right out. But it's still included, even though there's a significant portion where it's missing in terms of those streams of transmission. So the question is, did somebody cut it out, or did these people add it in? The majority text includes it. So the majority text included it, and so you have to argue they added it later. Whereas others would say they omitted it. And there's good arguments in both directions, and I'm not going to try the case for you. I just want you to know that the fact is that there are verses in the Bible like that where people don't know if it's in the original or not. If it was maybe in it, but then taken out by some, or if it's not there and then added later. Now, wait a second. What do I do if that's possible? Does that mean then that the entire New Testament is suspicious? Because once one verse is up for grabs, isn't the rest of it? Now, there are people, intelligent people, who have gone from Bible-believing Christians to agnostics and atheists because of that one little type of rock flowing down the mountain and starting the avalanche. Bart Ehrman of UNC is a great example of this, who wrote the very popular and famous book, Misquoting Jesus, in which he tries to show all these discrepancies. Now, would you be shocked to find out that in all of those streams of transmission that we have, there are over 200,000 textual variants? There's more than the words in the Bible. Some people put it up to 400,000. Oh my gosh. Is anything sacred? Is there anything we can know about anything anymore? Hold on. You know, this is the problem. You put a mic in front of an academic who says, well, see, there's so many thousands of variants, you can't trust it. Newsflash, Bible completely untrustable, Christians falling apart at the seams, next to the weather. Okay, most texts, this is where you have to know a little bit. A little bit of knowledge is really dangerous, so you have to know a little bit more before you jump over the cliff with the rest of the lemmings. Textual variations include things like spelling differences. Do I spell Ioannis with one N or two N's? John, yeah. Do I add, when I say, you know, how in English we say a tree but an orange? You put that little N on there. Sometimes in Greek you put on the N there if there's another word that has a vowel. Sometimes they didn't. Every single time that there was a little change like that, that's a textual variation. That's a textual variation. That's like 70% of the textual variations of the Bible right there. Then you get into the rest, they might be a phrase or a verse or a preposition, okay? When you all boil it down, there is not one single stream of textual variation that affects doctrine in any way, meaningfully. 99.5% of the New Testament as we have scholars believe is the original. And that 0.5% that's left, that, well, did they put that verse in? Did they take it out? Is stuff that's like, you know, the nitpickiest of stuff that doesn't affect core Christian doctrines. For example, so if we take out the verse, this cannot come out by prayer and fasting. Does that mean we should fast anymore? It's the fast right now. It's the remission fast. Well, if that's not in there, then I don't think I should have to fast anymore. That was something somebody made up to make me do something I didn't want to do. Make me eat fish. I don't know. No. 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 We don't base any of our doctrines on a single verse or a single word. In the case of Mark 29, which is the parallel of this miracle, it includes the whole verse except for the word and fasting. So it says, however, this cannot come out except by prayer. And then Mark 29 says, and fasting, but and you omits, or the minority text omits the fasting line. No. It doesn't mean anything. Most of us are not going to be exorcists. Most of us are not going to practice exorcism and have to wonder, do I need to pray and fast or just pray when I do this exorcism? Any of you doing exorcism on the side that I don't know about? No. That verse right there is probably the most potentially game-changing verse that we have a variation for. After that, it gets even less important, less meaningful, because our doctrines are based on the entire witness of Scripture. So go back to that wonderful passage that we just read. What's really the passage about? Is it about fasting? No. It's about the power of Christ to heal and the power of us to pray for that healing. And that with faith, that prayer is powerful. That's, no scholar doubts that that's the rest of the passage. Nobody else doubts that that is the original text. Okay? So the core of the gospel, and that's just one little bit, the core teaching there, the core doctrine is intact. And in fact, how does the whole passage end? Jesus said what? We're going to Jerusalem and the Son of Man will be betrayed and he'll die and he'll rise again on the third day. That's the important part. That's the important part. And that stands. Now, Oh yeah, still I don't know. I don't know. The fact that there's some textual variations, that troubles me. Well, there's this little thing called textual criticism. Okay? It doesn't mean that you criticize the text. It means that you critically study the different manuscripts and all the different texts, and that way you are able to reconstruct with great certainty what the original is, even if you don't have the original anymore. The way you do that is by having multiple streams of transmission available to you, so you have many manuscripts to compare. And then you can see who changed what and who changed what where and when. And then you can maybe guess why. When it comes to the New Testament is unlike any other document in the history of the world, up until the invention at least of the printing press, when standardization of copies became more ready. In fact, I wouldn't even say the printing press, but modern printing press techniques. Even the early printing presses were all hand set, right? Not until you could cut and paste on Windows was the ability to copy stuff so, you know, amazing. Homer's Iliad, which out of all the ancient documents of the world has the most number of manuscripts, somewhere around 650 manuscripts from which to figure out what the original text would have looked like, is one of the biggest. It's basically the biggest, if we're not talking about Bibles. 650 manuscripts, the earliest which is 500 years from the original, and most are from 1,000 years. But scholars of the Iliad aren't sitting there going, I don't think we can know what Homer really wrote. I don't think we can trust anything that we read in the Iliad as being anything like what they originally sang or did or whatever. Nobody thinks that. Okay? They all look at it and say, wow, we have an amazing amount of manuscripts with an amazing consistency of transmission, and we're very sure that this is what the original looked like. And nobody is batting an eye. How many manuscripts do you think we have available to us from the New Testament? 650 at least, do you think? How many copies of the Iliad could have been floating around compared to the New Testament? The fact is, if you just look at the Greek manuscripts of the original New Testament, we're looking at 5,000. If you add in the Latin, the Syriac, the Coptic, and so forth, parallel streams of transmission, you go up into the tens of thousands. When you add in all the fragments and all the things from like church lectionaries, like what we read from in church, that include verses of scripture in them, you're over 25,000 manuscripts. 25,000 manuscripts from the ancient world. The earliest one of which is from 125 AD, the piece of the Gospel of John. That's basically a copy of the original. Okay? One generation removed. There is no other book like the Bible in the history of the world in terms of ancient documents, in terms of its trustworthiness, in terms of the amount of data we have available to us to determine what the original texts were like. Brothers and sisters, what you have when you pick up your New Testament today, your Orthodox study Bible at least, is trustworthy. What it says about God is trustworthy. Now how you interpret it, that's another question, and we're going to get to that another day. But be assured, prayer and fasting or just prayer, either way, your New Testament is good. You can trust the Word of God. Amen. Christ is among us.
Yes, I shall.